76b, the Mishnah. חמישה דברים באים בטומאה ואינם נאכלים בטומאה. We learned in the previous chapter, on page 66, in regards to a differentiation between individual versus public when it's come to a offering. We said that one individual that involved with ritual impurity while he contacted the dead body, which is if one individual is involved in for example wrapping the body, touching the body of a corpse, then he cannot bring the paschal offering. Now if others, meaning if most of the people who involved with this are tmei met, involved with touching the corpse, so in that case we said that they can bring the paschal them, and this will apply not only to Passover, it's apply also to all other public offering. Now it's a side note, but in order to understand the Mishnah better, in order to postpone bringing certain offering, we have to have a certain condition. In other words, if you have a public offering and you said, okay, you cannot bring it, it's in a situation if almost everyone is ritually impure, or if most of the Kohanim, the priests, are ritually impure, or the Rambam tells us most of the utensils in Beit HaMikdash are ritually impure. Now, in those situations, usually we try to accept the offering as a public offering only if it's exceeded in such a level that we cannot bring. Now, there are some exceptions. For example, a ritual impurity involved with corpse. That situation we have, even as a public, we have to postpone it. We cannot accept it. So the Mishnah said five items, which means five offerings, may be brought in the state of ritual impurity. And then they said, ve'einan ne'echalin betumah, but they may not be eaten in a state of ritual impurity. Here are the list. Ha'omer, the offering of the omer. The offering of the omer, it's a public offering. It's called minchat tzibur. And they bring it on the 16 days of Nisan, which is the second day of Pesach. Ushtei alechem, and the two loaves that the bringing from chitim, from wheat, on the festival of Shavuot. Then velechem hapanim, lechem hapanim, it's the 12 chalot that they brought in Beit HaMikdash. In each one they have six, and they bring it as an offering. Vezivchei shalmei tzibur, there are two peace offering that brought during the festival of Shavuot, in addition to the bread. Then usirei rashei chodashim, and the goats sacrifice of the new moon, which are sin offering eaten by the Kohanim. However, Pesach sheba betum'ah, when you have a paschal lamb that is sacrificed in his impurity, so he said ne'echal betum'ah, even in a ritual impurity, can by force of circumstance can be eaten as is, shelo ba mitchilato ela le'achila. You remember we said it in endless times, that the paschal lamb is different than all the other offering, because paschal lamb, the key point is to have each and every individual involved of eating it. So in other words, the key purpose of that lamb is to have each person in the chabura eating from the Pesach lamb. Others, for example, why you bring the omer? You allow people to eat from the nukah. So, the two bread, so they can eat the tvuah chadasha, the lechem apanim, the bread of the shul bread. It's in order to make the table look beautiful. You bring in shalmei tzibu, the peace offering of the public, so the kohanim can eat it. So they said, chamisha lema'utei mai. So now the Gemara asks, we can make the calculation, but why the Mishnah mentioned number 5? What they want to emphasize by doing number 5? So they said, lema'utei chagigat chamisha asa. So that's applied to korban chagiga, that each and everyone has to bring it the first day of Pesach, and that's applied also to the other festivals such as Shavuot and Sukkot. And Rashi said they use Pesach as an example. The salka de'ata chamina, that if the Mishnah did not teach us specifically to that, what do you think that keivan dech korban tziburu, because it's a public offering? So Rashi said, the atya bechinufia ba'asefat chaverim baregel v'masechet yom al perek otzilo. So Rashi said that even each individual bringing it individually, but it's considering a public offering because it come with the group. They all come for the pilgrim. So they eat it as ukviya lemoed. They designated a time for that. Tidche tum'a. So you may think that will override the idea of ritual impurity. So the Mishnah in Tmura, chapter 14, dealing with the question, which offering override the issue of ritual impurity? So according to Tanakama, that's apply only to public offering, but not to an individual offering. So they said, Kamash Melan, this come to teach us that the Kevan de Itle Tashlumim, Kol Shiva, that if you didn't bring the offering at the 15th of Nisan, it's still the 7th day of Passover, you can bring it. Lo dachya Shabbat, umid the Shabbat, lo dachya tuma. So since that it does not override Shabbat, does not override ritual impurity, so what you understand that the offering may not be brought in a state of ritual impurity. So you have usually the moed. So it's not postponed to others, to not to Shabbat, not to tuma. So the Gemara asks, "V'neiten namei si'irei haregalim." So let also learn that the goats brought as a sin offering of the festival override ritual impurity, because they brought it even if they are ritually impure, but they don't eat it while they are ritually impure. So basically, that's apply only to Rosh Chodashim. So the Gemara said that Tanalei Zivchei Shalmei Tzibu, because it teaches that the communal, the category of communal peace offering. So they said, since we learned about specific offering that apply to a public, that you cannot eat it while it's ritually impure, so that's applied to all the other offering, including the gold for the festival. So Yaches Yireh Rashi Chodashim Name Lo Nitnei, that Tana Zivchei Shalmei Tzibur, and since you learned that it's a public offering, so that should be incorporated Rosh Chodesh. So why you say it specifically? Amrei, so they respond, 77, Seirei Rashi Chodashim Itzterichalei. He said that the necessary for the Mishnah to mention the goat sacrificed in the new moon Sar kadata chamina. You may think halo ktiv beumoed. So you may think the way Rashi said that the Torah do not enlist Rosh Chodesh as Moed. So since you tell me that the public offering override the ritual impurity, since it's written there, the word Moed, so you may think that that's not applied to the Rosh Chodesh, Kamash Melan, the Rosh Chodesh Ikre Moed. The Rosh Chodesh is under that category of festival. Kedabaye, Damar Abaye, that's from Tractitani, page 29. Tammuz de Haishat Amaluye Maluya, Dichtiv Karalai Moed, Ishbor Bachurai. It was a year that the spy was sent out, the second year when the children of Israel left Egypt. So they went to Eretz Yisrael and spy out. So that month, the Bet Din made it a full month, since it's written by Jeremiah in the book of Eicha, Kara Alai Moed, God proclaimed an appointed time, Lishbor Bachurai, against me to crush my young men. Meaning that the new moon was proclaimed in order to harm the Jewish people in the future. So in other words, it was a designated time that applied to the time of the Tisha B'Av. So Lishbor Bachurai, it's applied to the first and the second Beit HaMikdash. So what we understand? We understand the Rosh Chodesh, it Kol Moed. It's it designates Moed. For those who are not so familiar, it was the eve of Tisha B'Av, that everyone cried in vain when the spy came back and report, gave an evil report over Eretz Israel. And then they said, since you cry in vain, I make you cry for reason. So in short, they make that month a full month. So it was destined for time of Tisha B'Av until the Beit HaMikdash rebuilt. Lememra de kulu mi moed atu. So we learn the rule that all the public offering override the ritual impurity, and we derive it from the word moed, menale mile. How do you derive it? The Tanu Rabbanan, that we learn in the Braita. It's written at the end of the Moadim, when the Torah said in Parshat Emor and Vayikra, Leviticus 23, Vaydaber Moshe et Moadei Hashem el Bnei Yisrael, that Moses delivered the list of the Moadot to children of Israel, Ma Talmud Lomar. We said it already earlier in the Parasha, Vaydaber Hashem el Moshe Lemor, Hashem spoke to Moses saying, Daber el Bnei Yisrael, Amarta Lem Moadei Hashem, speak to children of Israel, tell them, these are the festivals. So it's already learned. Why do I need to repeat it? Lefi shelo lamadnu, ela letamidu Pesach, since we didn't learn those offering that you need to bring on Shabbat and the ritual impurity, solely in regard to offering of daily offering and Paschal lamb, shenemar behu b'moado, because we learned the word b'moado, that any offering was accepted, even is in a state of ritual impurity. So b'moado v'afilu b'shabbat, which means that you have to bring it even on Shabbat. B'moado v'afilu b'tuma, even they have a state of ritual impurity. Sh'ar korbanot tzibur minayin, how do you know that other public offering can be offered even on Shabbat or when they are ritually impure? Shenemar, because they said in Bamidbar, in the book of Numbers, chapter 29, Ele ta'asu la'ashem b'mo'adeichem. So it means that they have a fixed time, even Shabbat, even the time that they are ritually impure. Minayin lerabot Omer v'hakarev imo. How do you know that that's applied also to Omer offering or other offering that brought together? Shtei alechem hakarev imam. Talmud lomar vaydaber Moshe et Moadei Hashem el Bnei Yisrael. Hakatuv קבעו או קבע מועד אחד לכולם, meaning even Shabbat, even ritual impurity, all the public offering can be bought. So what's the purpose of all these derivations? It should have been sufficient to provide one derivation and use this as a model for all the other communal offering. So the Gemara said, "Tzricha, you need it." The I katav rachmanat. If the Torah used the word moed in a daily offering, hava minat tamid sheken tadir vechalil, aval Pesach shelo kamash melan. You may think that that's apply only to the offering that it's a that is a frequent and it's consumed. So this is entirely consumed as a burnt offering, as that it's why it overrides Shabbat and ritual impurity. But in regard to Paschal lamb, which does not have either of these point, which is it's not frequent, and therefore does not override Shabbat and ritual impurity. So therefore, it teaches us. ויקד רחמן הפסח פסח שחמור שנוש קראת, אבל תמיד שנוש קראת אימא לא כמש מלן. So you see, so therefore teaches the Paschal lamb also overrides Shabbat and ritual impurity. The same apply that if the mention the Paschal lamb for which they punish with karet, but daily offering that is not karet, if you somehow couldn't do it, you may say that he cannot bring it while the person is not totally pure. So therefore, the line, the pasuk, come to teach us that the tamid, the daily offering, needs to come on time regardless. So Tosfot, here I have a question. He explained that there is a, in short, he said that there is a tzad chamur, there is a point here of stringencies. He said, they have a chumra yetera, that is a chumra chashuva, it's the same as the tadir, that you have it all the times. So the Gemara asks, v'ikatav rachmana hanetartei, if the Torah used the word moed in regard to these two offerings, hava mina hanehu yesh baim tzad chamur. You think that this specific offering, they have a stringent aspect, tamid, tadir, v'chalil. The daily offering is frequent and entirely consumed on the altar. Now, Pesach shehu anush karet. In Pesach, that they have a punishment of karet. אבל שאר קורבנות ציבור, but the other public offering, that is no stringency, aim a law, that you may say that they come either in Shabbat or ritual impurity, כתב רחמנה, אלה תעשו להשם במועדיכם. That you have to bring the additional offering regardless. והיא כתב רחמנה, אלה תעשו להשם במועדיכם, אבא מינה, שאר קורבנות ציבור הבאים לחפר. אבל עומר ושתי הלחם דהן באים לחפר אלא להתיר בעל מנינו. לא. So you said that the reason we said that this you should bring in your festival, you think that that's applied to other public offering that comes an atonement. But the עומר and the two bread, that it's not as an atonement. It's only to allow the new crops. So lo kamash velan. So there the sentence said Moadei Hashem, that also this one you have the obligation to bring them on time regardless. Vi katav rachmana, if the Torah used the word moed, omer ushte alechem lechudaihu, that you bring this offering separate. But hava mina adraba, I may thinking the opposite. Omer ushte alechem, this offering you bring them on Shabbat and it's ritual impurity. Da alime, the ba'im le'atir, because they allow to use the new crop. דלים, אבל הנחלו, but other the offering. At come as a atonement, so you cannot bring them on Shabbat or ritual impurity, kamashmela. So therefore, the pasuk come and teach us that all these offering, you have the obligation to bring them on time, regardless. Svarua. So what we derive from that? Svarua. דלכו לאלמה תומעה דחויה היא בציבור. So you derive from that everyone agree that ritual impurity is overridden in case involving in public. So I wrote in my book, Birui HaKlomar Berashi Al Hashas, there is a Rashi here that said, HaKlomar HaHanach Rabbanan Desta Matnit In Savrei אין הציץ מרצה על אכילות. So the point that I think Bada Rashi is that apply only to one entity, but not to everyone else. But there is a Maharam here that try to differentiate between offering. Anyway, I wish to have more time. So ubaya letzitz leratzo de lekatana de shamat le de amar tumah utra batzibur el Rabbi Yehuda, only Rabbi Yehuda. The Tanya, tzitz ben sheyeshno al mitzcho ben sheyeshno meratze. The Kohen Gadol needs to have the tzitz. We study it several times. So regardless if it's in the Kohen Gadol, the high priest forehead or not, it still appeases God in our language. Now that's the Divrei Rabbi Shimon. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Rabbi Yehuda disagree, and he said no. Odeo al mitzcho meratzen, odeo al mitzcho eno meratzen. It's as long as it's the forehead of the Kohen Gadol, it's appeased Hashem. Otherwise, not. There is a Gemara in Yuma, page 7, dealing with that. Omar le Rabbi Shimon, Kohen Gadol b'Yom HaKippurim yochiach, she'eno al mitzcho meratze. So the proof is that in the Day of Atonement, it's not at the forehead of the Kohen Gadol. When he is doing the internal work, because he has the white garment and there's no tzitz. But anyway, it's appeasing even for the ritual impurity that happened in the offering at that time. Amar lo, Rabbi Yehuda said to Rabbi Shimon, hanach le Yom HaKippurim. You cannot compare to Yom HaKippurim to anything else. Sheken, tum'ah utra betzibur. So because that's what we said all the times, that ritual impurity, when it's come to a public offering, it's the public offering override the ritual impurity. Michlal de Rabbi Shimon Savar, tumat chuyai betzibur. We derive from that Rabbi Shimon hold that ritual impurity overridden in a case of involving in public, but is not wholly permitted. So therefore, what we said, that the front plate is needed in appease God for the sacrifice of the offering in a state of ritual impurity. Another assumption, udechu le'alma, we also assume that according to everyone, ein atzitz meratze al ha'achilot. This tzitz is not appeasing, is not for what? For all different offering that was eaten while it's in a ritual impurity. Because in that sense, the tzitz apply only for the portion of the work the offering that involved with work, which means the blood of the offering, the komets, the part it take for the mincha, but not the offering of regular meat or the leftover of the mincha. The leka tana de shamat le de amar. Hatzitz meratze al achilot. El Rabbi Eliezer, the only one who said that the tzitz appeasing any type of work, that's the only opinion of Rabbi Eliezer. The Tanya Rabbi Eliezer omer, hatzitz meratze al achilot. Rabbi Yossi omer, אין הציץ מרצה על אכילות. רב אלעזר said that the front plate appeases God for the impurity of the portions of the offering that's supposed to be eaten. And Rabbi Yossi said the front plate does not appease God for the impurity of portion of offering that is supposed to be eaten. So usually the Gemara said in Shabbat 130 that we don't go by Halacha Rabbi Eliezer. So Neima Matnitin Delok Rabbi Yoshua. So he may say that this Mishnah is not by the opinion of Rabbi Yoshua, the Tanya. It's written in the Torah book of the Deuteronomy chapter 12. Ve'asita olotecha abasar ve'adam al mizbach Hashem Elokecha. They said, and you shall sacrifice your burnt offering, the flesh and the blood, upon the altar of the Lord your God, and the blood of your offering shall be poured out against the altar of the Lord your God, and you shall eat the flesh. Morning.
Morning.
So, what we derive from that? Rabbi Yoshua Omer, Eim, Ein Dam, Ein Basar. Eim, Ein Basar, Ein Dam. Rabbi Yoshua said, if there is no blood, there is no meat. As the meat is also disqualified. And if there is no meat, that is fit for use, because something has become tamer, ritually impure, or was lost, there is no blood sprinkled on the altar, and the offering does not bring atonement. Rabbi Eliezer, disagreed, and he said, Dam af al pi she'ein basar. Blood brings atonement, although there is no suitable meat. שנאמר, ודם זבחיך ישפך המזבח השם אלוקיך ובשר תאכל. Because the Torah said, and the blood of your offerings shall be poured out. So blood is the aspect of the offering that most essential for atonement. ומה אני מקיים ועשית עולותיך בשר ואדם. And how do I uphold the significance of the juxtaposition of flesh and blood in the verse, and you shall sacrifice your burnt offering, the flesh and the blood. Lomar lecha, madam bizrika, av basar bizrika. So they tell you that the same way there is a blood presented upon the altar, toward sprinkling, it's the same way the meat is presented for throwing. So the Rashi said when they bring the burnt offering, the Kohen stand at the side of the altar and he throw from his vehicle to the side of the Mizbeach, the side of the altar. But the sin offering, the Kohen need to take the blood in his finger on those on the altar. So they said ומניק מקיים ועשית עולותיך בשר ואדם לומר לך מה דם בזריקה ובשר בזריקה ואומר you should say לול קטן that there is a small gap יש בין כבש למזבח you have between the ramp and the altar. So in order to fulfill the requirement to throw, so the Kohen will need to proceed in the process first, walking to arrangement to make the arrangement of the wood and putting down the meat. The Kohen need then to stand and throw the meat of the offering over the gap between the ramp and the altar, and then. Over there from the arrangement of the wood on the altar he can complete his work. So there is a different avenue here between Rashi and others what exactly the idea of throwing. The Rambam elaborates on that in Hilchot Beit Abchira. If we have time later we'll go there in practical halachot. Rabbi Yoshua Nami aktiv ודם זבחיך ישפך המזבח השם אלוקיך. Rabbi Yeshua, how we respond, because the Torah said, and the blood of your offering shall be poured out. that the blood, it means that the blood is basically an is essential part of the offering. So he said, Amar lach haktiv bei v'abasar tochel. The Torah said, and you shall eat the flesh, which means that there's an occasion that the meat is also essential and matztil be suitable for eating. 77b. So the Gemara asks, V'hane trei krai elamali. Why we need these two psukim? Because both of them teaches us the same idea, the same din, that if there's no meat, there's no blood. If there's no blood, there's no meat. So they said, chad be'ola v'chad be'shlamim. One is speak about burn offering, one is the peace offering. So Rashi said that shlamim is considering a zevach, because the shlamim, the peace offering, is eaten by the owner, and he called all his friends and his family to eat, and then he speaks about the greatness of Hashem. So that's called zevach. It's suda tzimcha, is the meal of joy. Utzricha, and we need both. The ikatav rachmana be'ola, that if the Torah speaks solely about the ola offering, hava mina olai dechamira sheken kalil, because it needs to do it totally on the altar. Aval shlamim delo chamirei, because the rest of the meat of the shlamim can be eaten. Eimalo, so you should say that you sprinkle the blood, even the meat is not there. V'ikatav rachmana shlamim, if the Torah said solely, only peace offering, hava mina adrabah deit b'shtei achilot. I may think the opposite, that's a appeal, because the meat can be eaten by people, and the pieces that left can be eaten by the fire of the altar. Aval ola, burn offering, that it's not so, we don't hold it in such a level of stringency. The late bash teachilot, because what happened to a burn offering? You have totally to burn it on the altar. You cannot do anything with that. Eimalo, you may think that that's din is not applied to it. Kamash melan, the Torah teaches us that the condition is that the meat is there when the Kohen throw the blood, regardless if it's a burn offering or peace offering. And since we learn from these two, we can derive from all the other offering. The Tosfot asks, if you don't learn peace offering from the burn offering, so what exactly the meaning of the blood? Anyway, the Rabbi Eliezer Nami, but opinion of Rabbi Eliezer, we also may ask, Hakti ve'abasar tochel. So it means that the meat has to be there. So how we explain these words? Amar lach haomi ba'ele she'en abasar mutar ba'achilat she'izarek adam. You cannot eat the meat until you sprinkle the blood on the altar. So the Gemara asks, Yache ima kule le'ache u'de'ata. You may teach that the whole pasuk teach us, because we use the word v'dam zvachecha yishafech, that whatever the blood left, you should put it out. So dam afal pi she'en sham basar menala. So how do you know that blood, that even is no meat there? So he said, Amar lach, im ken ichtov rachmana basar tochel, v'adar dam zvachecha yishafech. The order the Torah put, it's first the meat, and then the blood. So the way that the Torah put it is in the opposite order. Kidichti bereisha v'asita olotecha basar v'adam, because they said about the burn offering that you have to make meat and the blood. Ma'ishna de akdemei ledam zvachecha. Why? What's the reason at the end of the pasuk the Torah turn over, reverse the order, and put first the blood of the offering yishafech before the word abasar tochel, that you should eat the meat? Shma mina dam afal bi she'en basar. You derive from that even the blood bring atonement, although there is no meat. Ushma mina she'en abasar mutar ba'achilat she'izarek adam. that the meat is not permitted to be eaten until the blood is sprinkled. So since the blood is written at the very end of the pasuk that used the word yishafer, we mean that we eat the meat only after the blood was put out. Rabbi Yoshua, how Rabbi Yoshua explained it, he said, "En abasar mutar ba'achilah shizarek adam." The meat is not permitted to be eaten until the blood is sprinkled. And how? Kal v'chomer. We derived it from kal v'chomer. How? Uma imurin dechilitan hu lo me'akvei, just as it regards to sacrificial portion that brought in the altar, which is not preclude acceptance of the offering when they are not present. Ki at itan hu me'akvei, but when they are present, they do preclude the eating of the meat. So he said, "Dam dechileitei me'akev, ki eitei lo kol sheken de me'akev." So he said, when it's come to blood, which precludes the acceptance of the offering, when it's not present, which means when it's become ritually impure or lost, when it's present. How much so, it's not clear that it preclude the continuation of the service and the eating the meat until it's sprinkled. So Rabbi Eliezer, how will you respond to that? Rabbi Eliezer said, you can learn it from this Kal Vachomer, Milta Ve'atya Be'Kal Vachomer Tarach Ve'Chatav Lakra. That's a rule that you see in principle many times in the Talmud, that anything that comes with the Kal Vachomer, so the Pasuk needs to say it specifically and clearly. So if it's no meat, it's no blood. So how Rabbi Yeshua explained this? He said, Rabbi Yeshua, kol heichad de midrash darshinan. Rabbi Yeshua said, in anywhere that there is a possibility to expound the verse and thereby drive the halacha, we expound it, rather than explain the verse taught by only by halacha that could also have been driven in a different manner. Hashta leima matnitin delo ke Rabbi Yeshua. This Mishnah, so not matching Rabbi Yoshua's way. So now, when we understand Rabbi Yoshua have this principle only, not only for the burn offering, but also for the peace offering. And so now we need to compare it to others. So how? He said, Hashta leima matnitin de lo ki Rabbi Yoshua de kemanda amar be'inan tartei, because Rabbi Yuda said that you need to have both, to sprinkle the blood for two pieces of the two entities involved with the offering, which is the meat and the blood, that both of them needs to be there, and ksherim v'tzitz ha'achilot lo meratzeh. So if it's a state of ritual impurity, so the tzitz is not appeasing for that part that was eaten together, that part of the offering. Heichei atei betum'ah. So how the offering can come when it's in a ritual impurity, since you tell me that the tzitz is not appeasing for the food that was eaten, so he remained in that state of disqualification. And according to Rabbi Yoshua, you cannot sprinkle the blood. So the Gemara responded, said, "Afilu teima Rabbi Yoshua." Even you may say that the Mishnah match the opinion of Rabbi Yoshua. Ela kasav Rabbi Yoshua, atzitz meratze al haolim. The tzitz applied to the offering that was on the altar. So since Rabbi Yoshua have the rules that if it's no meat, it's no blood, it means that if it's lost or become disqualified, you don't sprinkle the blood. But if you have some qualified, you can sprinkle the blood. Ha teinach zvachim. That's good Well, in regard to communal animal offering, the ika olin, so there are portions that go up into the altar. Ela omer ushte alechem de leika olin. But what about the omer offering and the two loaves which there are no parts that go up on the altar? My ika lemeimar, how you can bring them in the ritual impurity according to opinion of Rabbi Yoshua. Amrei ki amar Rabbi Yoshua named ba'inan tartei, when Rabbi Yoshua said that these two parts of the offering, which is the blood and the meat, that's applied bezvachim, that's applied to the offering. Bemnachot lo amar, but with regard to a meal offering, he did not say it. So you tell me that regard to a meal offering did not say that the requirement that both the handful and the remainder of the meal offering remain valid? Ve'atnan, this is a famous Mishnah in Tractate Menachot, chapter 26. Nitme'u shiareya, if the remainder of the meal offering, which is everything left after the handful has been separated, so nisrefu shiareya, avdu shiareya, kemidat Rabbi Eliezer kshera, kemidat Rabbi Yoshua psula. So according to the principle of Rabbi Eliezer, we said that the blood is fit, even is no meat, so it's fine, it's valid. But they, according to Rabbi Yoshua, is disqualified. So it means that this Mishnah, that the principle of Rabbi Yoshua, applies also to menachot. So the Gemara said, no, kemidat velo kemidat, according to the principle of Yeshua, but not entirely according to the principle of Rabbi Yeshua, meaning that the statement in the Mishnah is similar, but not entirely consistent with the opinion of Rabbi Yeshua. Kemidat Rabbi Yeshua de bainan tarti, need to, velo kemidat Rabbi Yeshua de Rabbi Yeshua bizvachim amar, b'menachot lo amar, velo haitan asavar afilu b'menachot. And the other one, Rabbi Yeshua holds that it's applied even in a meal offering. Umano aitana de karek vateu machmir tfeiminei, which is the Tana that holds the same as Rabbi Yeshua, that you need the two parts of the offering, but he stringent more, and he applied that to other menachot. Ve'od Tanya, we learn another brighter clearly. Omar Rabbi Yossi. רואה אני דברי רבי אליעזר במנחות ובזבחים ודברי רבי יהושע בזבחים ומנחות. So I see as correct the statement of Rabbi Eliezer both in regard to meal offering and regard to animal offering, and I see the correct statement of Rabbi Yeshua both regard to animal offerings and regard to meal offering. So he explained it, דברי רבי אליעזר בזבחים שהיה אומר דם אף על פי שאין שם בשר, ודברי רבי יהושע בזבחים שאומר אם אין דם אין בשר, אם אין בשר אין דם. So I see both of them. If you go by Rabbi Eliezer, the animal offering, so he said that that's applied if the blood brings atonement, although there is no meat. And the other one is too, when there's no blood, there is no meat. So there's no meat, there's no blood. שהיה אומר, because he used to say, קומץ אף על פי שאין בו שיריים, that the handful is fit although there is no reminder. דברי רבי יהושע בן מנחות, רבי יהושע is correct in the meal offering, שהיה אומר אם אין קומץ אין שיריים, אין שיריים אין קומץ. He said that if there is no valid handful, there is no reminder, if there is no reminder, there is no handful. So that's indicate that Rabbi Yoshua disputes the opinion of Rabbi Eliezer concerning meal offerings, just disputes his opinion concerning animal offering. Ela kasavar Rabbi Yoshua. So whether the previous answer should be rejected, so the answer is follow. Rabbi Yoshua hold, tzitz meratze ala olin ve'ala achilot, that the front plate appeases God for both the impurity of the sacrificial olin that go up unto the altar, and for the impurity of portions of offering that are supposed to be eaten. So the Gemara now rejected all the previous assumption, according to the opinion of Rabbi Yoshua, that the tzitz, the front plate, does not appease God for the impurity of the portion of the offering that are eaten. So they said, Yache amaykim yata Yoshua psula. So what do you mean, according to our principle of Rabbi Yoshua, that the impure offering is disqualified? So he said, Avud vesaruf. That's applied to something is lost and burned. However, if it become ritually impure, the front plate appeases God and the offering remain valid. Ela nitma lemaikatane. So who hold that in case of meal offering become impure? So they said, le Rabbi Eliezer pshita. If you go by Eliezer, it's obvious that the meal offering remains valid. Hashta yesh lomar avud v'saruf deleit nehu machshir Rabbi Eliezer nitma deite mibaye. So it's obvious that if it's that leftover is there, even that so why Rabbi Eliezer needs to make this mincha machshir, make it available? For sure it's okay. So you have to say ela pshita le Rabbi Yoshua. You have to say that we go here by Rabbi Yoshua. Uktanei psula. So we teaching that according to him is disqualified. So it means that the Mishnah come and teach us that according to Rabbi Yoshua, it's not enough that leftover is not there and it's not the whole idea of appeasing. It's this mincha offering is disqualified, but even that if it's there, but it become ritually impure, you cannot use that comets because this tzitz is not appeasing for those food. Tana Rabbi Yeshua Omer, kol zvachim sheba Torah. Also Rabbi Yeshua said, all the animal offering that written in the Torah, ben shenitma basar v'chalav kayam, ben shenitma chelev u'basar kayam, zoreket adam, ava nitmaut ravayu lo. He said, well, that the meat become ritually impure and the fat of the offering, which is part of the animal burnt on the altar, remain valid. Or the fat become impure and the meat remains valid, one may sprinkle the blood. But if both of them become ritually impure, so you cannot sprinkle the blood. So what do we derive from that? Alma kasavar Rabbi Yoshua, en hatzitz meratzeh al ha'olim velo al ha'achilot. Which means the front plate does not appease God for impurity of the part of the offering and go up onto the altar, or for the impurity of portions of the offering that are supposed to be eaten. Ela l'olam Rabbi Yeshua imatnitin. So you have to say that the Mishnah go by Rabbi Yeshua velo kashya. Kan lechatchila, kan bediavad. So he said that one is lechatchila, the other one is only that what's already the blood was there. So, ki amar Rabbi Yeshua lechatchila. So the chatchila, how you should do the work, if the two part of the offering is befitting. But bediavad, but if it's after the fact, lo, he did not disqualify it. Umenat teimra deshanel Rabbi Yeshua ben lechatchila bediavad. How do you know that he differentiate between lechatchila or after the fact? The Tanya. Nitma basar o shenifsal o sheyatza chutz laklayim. So learn the bright that the meat become impure or it was disqualified. For example, if it's immersed during the day but does not become fully pure until the nightfall. So they said he went outside the area and they become ritually disqualified. So Rabbi Eliezer Omer Yizarek. Rabbi Eliezer said that the blood may be sprinkled, which is valid. Rabbi Yeshua Omer lo yizarek. Said no, blood cannot. Rabbi Yeshua shim zarak utzad. It says if bediavad, it's already sprinkled the blood, so the offering is accepted bediavad after the fact. So the Gemara rejected that. They said chada de psula diavad mashma. What we understand that one reason it's because reject the term disqualified indicate that the offering is invalid after the fact, but it's not lechatchila. The odd is another point here. Chamisha dvarim ba'im Remember the language in the Mishnah? We use the term five. We say that the five items may be brought in a state of ritual impurity. So what we derive from that? Lecha tchila machma. What we indicates that it may be brought even lecha tchila. So how do you learn that the Mishnah said that it's appeasing only after the fact? Ela Lukashya 78. So the contradiction between Rabbi Yoshua and the Mishnah, it's not an issue. Kan biyachid, kan betzibur. So the Gemara basically backed off the original Amoraic opinion that the Mishnah applied to ritual impurity that only it's in public. So it means that only in the Mishnah we state that it may be sacrificed. Lechatchila, it's referring to an offering that involved the public. So the public, as we said, if it's a public offering, even some of the people are ritually impure, we accepted the offering. Rambam, Sefer Avodah, Ilchot Beit HaMikdash, Chapter 4. Korbanot HaTzibur Betum'ah. All communal offerings are sacrificed even in a state of ritual impurity because they have a set time on which they must be sacrificed. Those who are supposed to be eaten may not be consumed in a state of ritual impurity, rather the appropriate part of the sacrifice on the altar and the rest is burned. Now we said when the Paschal lamb is sacrificed in a state of ritual impurity, it may also be eaten in ritual impurity. In that case, it may be consumed only by those who are ritually impure due to contact with a corpse or another source of impurity. People who are ritually impure due to bodily emissions may not be eaten. We say that Rambam, Sefer HaKorbanot Ilchot Chagiga, festival peace offering do not override Shabbat or the halachot of ritual impurity because the time of this offering is not entirely set. As you know, they have the Zmanim and the time is constantly changed. Now,
Good morning.
We said also that that a tzitz, meratzeh al achilot, the Kohen carried the tzitz, the front plate. So that's the appease God for several type of ritual impurity relating to offering in the temple. However, it does not appease God with regard to ritual impurity of the portions of offering that are consumed by the Kohanim. Therefore, the Kohanim may not eat any part of the offering that it's impure. Now we explain that there is a certain time, and that's the last halacha of today. There is a certain time involved with those offering, and we said it is prohibited to eat meat or of any offering, including offerings of lesser sanctity, before its blood has been sprinkled on the altar. One who does so is punished with the malkot for having violated the prohibition. It is said in Deuteronomy 12. You may not eat within your gates. So that's according to the Gemara and Tractate Makot, has to be the blood. We are very careful. The blood should not be there in any form. And that's the Rambam, Ilchot Maaseh HaKorbanot, chapter 11.